All right, we'll come to order. Today is the Wednesday, July 21st, 2010, regular meeting of the Glendale Planning Commission. Could you call roll, please?
Regan?
Present.
Mr. Lee?
Here.
Here.
Mr. Visayan?
Here.
Here, report regarding posting of agenda.
The agenda for this meeting was posted on Wednesday, July 14th, 2010, on the bulletin board outside City Hall and on the city's website.
Thank you. Would everyone stand and please join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Approval of minutes. We have two to approve. First, the July 7th, 2010 minutes. Any comments, corrections?
Move approval.
Second.
Motion for approval and a second. Call roll, please.
Regan?
Yes.
Mr. Lee?
Yes.
Keith?
Aye.
Visayan?
Yes.
Aye. On a vote of 5-0, the minutes of July 7th, 2010 were approved. And now for the revised minutes of April 21st.
Move approval.
Second.
Second.
We have at least one motion and one second. Could you call roll, please?
Commissioner Landrigan?
Aye.
Commissioner Lee?
Aye.
Commissioner Sheets?
Aye.
Commissioner Visayan?
Yes.
Aye. On a vote of 5-0, the revised minutes of April 21st, 2010 were approved. And agenda item 5, oral communications. I have no cards under that. We'll move to agenda item 6A. It's new business, a conditional use permit, PCUP 2009-019, a parking reduction permit, case PR 2009-008, and a parking use permit, case PUP 2009-005. This is at 615 through 617 South Brand Boulevard, and I believe the applicant's representative is actually pulling the appeal. Would staff like to comment on that?
That's correct. In your package, you should have gotten a letter from Melka Toledo, the planner. In a letter dated June 30th, the appellant's representative, Ms. Janelle Williams, requested to withdraw the appeals.
All right. So do we take action to remove from calendar, or do we just let this go on?
It's being withdrawn, right?
They've withdrawn, so okay, no action on our part.
Right.
Very good. We'll move on to 6B. Standards variance PVAR 2009-042. This is at 1714 through 1716 Orchard Avenue. It is a request to reverse the denial of a standards variance to demolish an existing detached, fully covered, and enclosed two-car garage and construct a replacement three-car carport in lieu of a new two-car, fully covered, enclosed garage. And again, I believe there was a problem with posting, and staff is asking that it be continued to August 18th without public notice, further public notice?
That's correct, Chairman Kane and Commissioners. Due to the improper posting of the site, staff is requesting that the appeal be continued to August 18th, 2010 without further notice.
All right, thank you very much. Could we have a motion to do so?
Motion to this.
Motion and support?
Second.
Okay.
Commissioner Landrigan?
Aye.
Commissioner Lee?
Aye.
Commissioner Sheets?
Aye.
Commissioner Visayan?
Aye.
Chairperson
Kaye? Aye. And to clarify, that was a motion to continue the PVR case 2009-042 to the August 18th, 2010 Planning Commission meeting without further public notice. Moving on to 7A, it's zoning code amendment case PZON 2009-001. The location is citywide. It was initiated by the city, and it is amendments to Title 30 of the Glendale Municipal Code relating to modifications to facilitate the installation of solar energy equipment consistent with state law. The staff is going to recommend that we review the draft ordinance amending Title 30 of the Municipal Code to facilitate installation of solar equipment and provide a recommendation to City Council. Could we have an overview from staff, please?
Yes, Chair.
Mike? We know what that phone call is.
Pavlov's dog. When we hear the ring, we look for somebody's.
I'll start over. This hearing is being continued from the June 2nd Planning Commission meeting. At that meeting, two draft ordinances were discussed. They both provided for some flexibility with respect to interior setback, lot coverage, and landscape ratio for solar equipment. The Planning Commission at that time gave the direction to staff to increase the amount of flexibility, include in the areas where flexibility was being provided, include the front setback also and the street side setback in the list of items that were given additional flexibility. And to extend that provision for street front setback and street side setback only when applicable to existing entitlements for buildings located in those areas. So draft ordinance option C has been prepared based on the Planning Commission's direction. In a nutshell, the amount of flexibility has been increased from 20% to 30%, and this would provide for some encroachment into the minimum required interior setback. The 30% would also provide additional flexibility to decrease the amount of required landscaping so that solar installations can be provided, and to also increase the amount of lot coverage when applicable to solar installations. With respect to the street front setback and the street side setback, the way we drafted the ordinance is to allow a solar installation over a building that has an entitlement to be located in the street front setback or street side setback, either by variance, by administrative exception, or by nonconforming right. And the way the ordinance is drafted, the solar installation would be limited to the footprint of such building where there's an encroachment or an entitlement and not beyond. And the ordinance wouldn't apply to structures, only buildings, which have, by definition, a roof. I'm going to hand out some definitions now, and we can talk probably a little more about them. So the reasoning behind this was to disallow, for instance, an installation over a pole sign that may have a setback variance, for instance, but to allow it over a building such as a garage or a house or a commercial office building. With respect to the list of structures where such an installation would be prohibited, we've relaxed that provision to allow a solar installation over a deck or a pool, swimming pool, which may have a variance, for instance, and that variance entitlement or nonconforming entitlement would be allowed to extend to a solar installation. Only with respect to the interior setback, not with respect to the street or the front setback or the side street setback. There's also a provision to allow for an increased height. At that time, at the June meeting, when we discussed a particular proposal on Marion Drive, which is a detached garage built in the front setback, which has a limitation in height in the zoning code, we figured the easiest or the simplest way to do it would be to allow for a 15-foot additional height limitation on top of what's allowed by code. So this provides for angling of panels or angling of a structure, enough flexibility for headroom, and can accommodate different scenarios, but only over a building or two other types of structures, which are swimming pools and decks, detached decks. So all this is in the ordinance. In the staff report, we've also pointed out how the draft ordinance would benefit the permit application that's on file at the Marion Drive property. Having said this, I would like to hand out two handouts for
what we got here. Let's see. Too technical for me.
I'll go over these. The one sheet handout is a list of definitions from the zoning code, and this talks or defines what a building is versus a structure. A building is anything basically that has a roof on top. So a garage or a fully covered carport would be a building. A parking structure is a building. So the flexibility that's being provided in the draft ordinance would extend to this list of buildings. Accessory structures would include non-covered structures such as trash enclosures, for instance, freestanding signs, flagpoles maybe, and some other structures like that. And staff thought it wouldn't be advisable to extend that level of flexibility to structures, just buildings.
That have variances.
That have variances or other no variances. Okay. Because you may have a building, let's say, that's within at the maximum allowable height or within the maximum allowable height. This ordinance would provide for another 15 feet on top of the allowable height to provide for the solar structure. Or if there's a variance, that variance could be extended to the solar structure, provided it remains within that variance area, within the footprint of the building, not extend beyond. Because the reasoning was the following. Let's take, for instance, the proposed structure on Marion Drive. The garage has a setback variance, but the extent of the variance applies to the footprint of the garage, not beyond. If that were allowed to extend beyond the footprint of the garage, potentially the entire front setback could be covered by the solar structure and not be limited. The solar structure wouldn't be limited to the footprint of the garage. It would extend across. So this is one handout. And the second handout, while reviewing the code further, we came across a provision in the administrative exception of the code. And we made a proposed revision to this, and it's in paragraph C in the middle of the first page. This provision was put in place a few years ago to allow covering of parking structures with trellises or solar panels. This provision that applies to the solar panel portion must be deleted because the ordinance that's being proposed is more generous, more flexible than what's in here. And besides, this provision implies a discretionary review, mm-hmm. which is something that we're trying to steer away from. So this is another provision that we came across that needs to be modified, but it's not in the draft ordinance. So if the Planning Commission makes a motion to move forward with the ordinance, this needs the administrative exception provision needs to be incorporated also. I would like to wrap up my presentation unless there are questions of the board.
Any questions for staff at this time? Ms. Landrigan?
In the section you just handed out on administrative exceptions, on page 252G, where it says rooftop equipment except solar energy equipment,
right.
That phrase fits the new definition?
The definitions and the permitted structures in the code have been divided into two. There are different provisions that apply to rooftop equipment, and there used to be different provisions applicable to solar energy equipment, but they are different. There are different sets of regulations. So this is to clarify that rooftop equipment is not the same as solar energy equipment, and the discretionary review that applies to rooftop equipment doesn't apply to solar energy equipment.
So I'm just wondering if G needs cleaning up too, or is the definition here where you say rooftop equipment except solar energy equipment only for the location of the equipment? Does it even need to say except solar energy equipment?
It doesn't need, but we would like to keep it there for clarity purposes. And in fact, in the draft ordinance, we have a similar provision that says
Okay.
I can find it in a moment. That repeats the same thing.
It's actually...
It's on page 37.
Page 37, yeah.
Yeah,
I was looking at the two of those together.
We put it in there for clarity purposes.
Okay.
One additional thing, if I may point out. On page 38 of the draft ordinance...
Find out here, yeah.
Under section 30.30.050, the opening paragraph, the last sentence says solar energy equipment shall not be subject to the development plan review process of section 30.15.040F. This provision is in the SR zone, and in the SR zone, any development, any proposed construction is subject to planning commission review. And we put this specifically in here so that a solar component would not be subject to planning commission review. There's no height limit in the SR zone. There's no setback limitation in the SR zone. So this allows for some construction without having to be reviewed by the planning commission, which would imply some discretionary review.
Okay.
Mr. Lee.
Yeah, just for the clarification purposes, when you mentioned definition of a solar equipment, did you say that was including all the support structures, the lattice work, whatever,
yes,
that is associated with the solar panels is all as a part of the solar equipment?
Yes. Here.
So
that, and that's how it's defined in the code, it's the entire package.
Okay, so the any then structure part that holds up, that I guess encroaches into the setback area, then will be considered that it is in the, violating the setback area.
Right.
Requirements. Okay.
There's a provision to allow flexibility with respect to the interior setback, mm-hmm, with respect to the street front and street side setbacks. That flexibility is allowed only when there's a variance, okay, entitlement or an administrative exception.
The second is that I need the clarification on your 30% increases on the coverage, Section E coverage.
Yes.
When you say the increase of the 12%, I guess, you know, which is 30% of the 40%.
Right.
Are you allowing living spaces increase or just the area that is required just for the solar equipment?
It's not an increase in the living spaces or floor area or any other standard. It's just the solar equipment.
I think components. You need to kind of specify that, because when I read this, it almost sounds like we're giving, 12% more, that you're allowed to do that here in the coverage. So I think it needs to be a little bit more specific.
We could clarify that further, yes.
And your table 30.11A and 30.12-A, page 5 and page 12, where the permit requirements, that's been struck out. So what does, it's for clarification purposes. So what you're saying is then, those do not require, the solar equipment does not require any permit processes.
In the staff report?
Oh, no, on the table, 30.11-A and 30.12-A, that's page 5 and page 12.
Draft option 2C.
Okay, on page 5, we crossed out
right
solar energy equipment from
permit requirements,
the accessory buildings and structures, and we listed it separately as a development standard, not as a use.
Okay, so, but when I see that, when you struck something out like that, I know we're trying to be very lenient, but what that tells me is that doesn't have to go through any permit process. Because normally when it says P, then that means you have to go to a permit process. There's a permit requirement, correct?
No. Let me clarify that. If we scroll further to page... Give me 1 second.
There's one on page 5 and page 12, 30.11 and 30.12.
Right, right.
Yeah.
They are not automatically permitted. They still have to go through a permit process. So if it says, if it's listed as a P in the table, doesn't mean it's automatically allowed without a permit. They require a permit. a P means it's allowed by right without discretionary review. In these tables, initially, solar energy equipment was listed as an accessory building or a use. Mm-hmm. So we took it out from the listing under accessory uses. We put it as a development standard, so it becomes similar to rooftop equipment or some other equipment which require permits, but they are not uses by themselves because they are part of a building.
Then I guess I need to come back to you then saying, okay, because when I look at this the table, it tells me, yes, I need to pull the permit for this type of equipment to install. Now, if you're going to take this out of the this accessory structures and uses, and same thing with the other table, shouldn't you have them put it back into some other table, the guiding people to say that, that you do, you know, these are some of the things that, that's associated with the solar equipment that is, you know, we have a very lenient, you know, application rules, but you still need to go through a permit process?
Actually, no, and the answer is, can we go to page 15 of the draft ordinance? This is a table of the commercial development standards. Okay. And for instance, in the table, if we look on the left side, left column, rooftop equipment is listed towards the bottom, and it says next to it, C-section such and such. Mm-hmm. Rooftop equipment requires a permit, but it's treated as a development standard, not as a land use in itself. Further down, lighting. Lighting, for instance, could be on light posts or some other way. They do require permits. Trash collection areas, they do require permits.
If I may, Mr. Chair, I think, well, Kristen just told me that among the staff who work on the code, that's Kristen, Chris, and Wolf, there has been some debate on this issue. And just the fact that you raised the question and it's causing further confusion and discussion tells me that we should keep that language in the table as mentioned by you, Commissioner Lee. And I think it's safest to keep it under the uses under on the table. At this point, we would recommend that we keep it in the, at the table unless otherwise directed by the commission, or if you'd like, you could add in the final motion language that gives us discretion to remove it by the time we go to the city council if there is good reason to remove it.
Could just to add to that, I notice in the right column in all of the charts that you have the section. Maybe in this case it would be appropriate to put that in there, which now refers us to what those development standards, just to be kind of a safeguard.
Great idea. Thank you.
If I may add another point with respect to what Commissioner Lee brought up earlier, on page 38 of the ordinance, and this is regarding the lot coverage ratio that can extend to other features of the building, on page 38, the first paragraph under 30.30.050, this says, notwithstanding any other provisions of this title, and then it continues to say, the following development standards on the second line shall be modified as listed below when applicable to solar energy equipment in order to facilitate the installation. So we thought this opening sentence would make it clear that this is only applicable to solar energy equipment and not to floor area ratio or other features. If it needs further clarification, we'll clarify it further. We understand the intent.
Okay.
Any other questions at this moment for staff? Can always come back to them.
It's double.
Anything right now, anyone?
Nothing.
All right. I have one speaker card. It's Scott Peer.
Good evening. I'm Scott Peer. Thank you for listening. You might say I'm the instigator for this whole thing. In 2007, I selected an architect and a solar contractor to design my solar system. In October 2008, GWP approved the plans, but planning rejected our building permit application and claimed I needed to apply for a variance. The description for this zoning code amendment case states that it's for modifications to facilitate installation of solar equipment consistent with state law. However, at the last meeting, the commission recommended changes to option two. The California Deputy Attorney General said are, quote, in direct conflict with the law. Also, the option two changes, according to Glendale planner Chris Bagdikian, would not facilitate solar energy. I know they would not help my case, which begs the question of why the commission would recommend an option that achieves neither of the purposes of the amendment. The changes for option one, removal of all zoning restrictions on solar systems, have been complete for months. Similar provisions have been implemented successfully in other cities, including Berkeley and Pasadena. It's effective both in achieving legal compliance and facilitating solar energy. The city received a letter from California Deputy Attorney General Deborah Slaan on February 9th of this year. The letter states the city is not complying with the law. The letter states option one would correct the problem by removing all the zoning restrictions, and it states option two is in direct conflict with the law. The letter states all of the arguments used by the city to support their position lack merit. The letter urges the city to correct its noncompliance with the Solar Rights Act of 1978. City's attorney's office has shown over the last year and a half creativity in making bogus excuses for violating the Solar Rights Act, but the excuses are more useful than saying everyone else is doing it or the dog ate my homework. The California Deputy Attorney General's office is a higher authority on state law, and their written opinion is that the Glendale City Attorney is wrong and the city is violating the law. Contrary to what Mr. Garcia says, court cases have backed up the opinion of the California Attorney General's office as well. Barry Cinnamon took Los Gatos to court in a similar case and won. It was also the case of Arterberry versus County of San Diego on March 23, 2010, which resulted in a $125,000 settlement that included damages and attorney's fees for the plaintiff. The report for this meeting says that option 2C, every proposal would require review by the Planning Division for its compliance with new zoning standards. It also says this may not be completed during the first visit to the Permit Services Center. It also says prior to preparing plans, it would be necessary for prospective applicants to contact the Planning Division to obtain relevant zoning information. In other words, option 2C does not facilitate solar systems at all. Instead, it adds more obstacles for all the people who want to help reduce pollution by installing solar energy. The planning report brings up our proposal at Marion Drive. That's good to discuss, even though it makes a series of complaints about our application, most of which are either not true, were never expressed to the contractor or myself, or relate to information that the city could have seen in its existing files on the property. On October 6, 2008, GWP approved our plans, and my contractor went directly to the building department to get a building permit. The building department would not even accept the application. They tried several more times to get the application accepted, but could not even get the department to accept the application, much less approve it. Finally, on June 1st, 2009, I got them to accept the application after considerable arm twisting. We hoped to get all the issues besides zoning clear so that zoning could be addressed as a single issue. We thought that at least they could reject the application on the basis of zoning and we could appeal the decision. Notice that throughout the ensuing months, Jan Baer, the plan checker, never once answered the phone for us or returned any of the dozens of phone calls we made. Instead, on July 2nd, they completed the review more than a month later, although they never notified us, so there was some delay in picking it up. I basically just had to keep calling in. The corrections were mostly indicative of not having looked closely at the application and the department's refusal to contact us for clarifications. On August 28th, the updated plans were resubmitted. That's these plans right here. After more than 3 months, I went and picked up the plans on December 18th, and they still had not been fully reviewed. Jan Baer had made some vague comments on them, which you're welcome to look at anytime, but had not even sent them to the appropriate departments for review and did not even sign or date his work. His main effort was to change the description from photovoltaic array installation on structure mounted on garage of single family residence, that's what we wrote, to new second story patio cover on existing one story garage, solar panels on top of patio cover. That's not even factually correct. In other words, when it really comes down to it, the zoning rules are academic and the building department can capriciously block an application regardless of its merit. The report claims that, quote, the building permit application describes a project as solar PV shade structure, parentheses, new cover on aluminum structure. As I just stated, that's not what we wrote or Jan Bayer wrote. I have no idea where that came from. It's not even correct because the vertical part of the structure is steel. The report claims the plans provided for the project are reductions and are difficult to read. I welcome you to look at these plans. You can see they are full size. I don't know if they want, you know, 20 foot wide or what they're looking for, but these look like full size plans to me.
I'll just interrupt and say you really don't want us to look at those plans because we'll keep them. Seriously, so well, you can refer to them unless there's a copy you can give up. We want to be very careful about what you actually present.
Yeah. Okay. The report also claims that non-photovoltaic materials will be used as part of the cover. This is simply false. The parts of the structure that do not have solar panels are to remain open to the sky, as shown in the plans. This is not a roof; it's a solar system. The report states the system would extend beyond the footprint of the garage. That's true as long as you want to quibble about a few inches for the attachments. Alternative approaches completely within the footprint would be possible, but they would be structurally inferior. The report also discusses a possible need for a property line survey. This would clearly fall under what California Government Code 65850.5 calls an unreasonable barrier. In summary, the report completely misrepresents our proposal and fails to mention the tactics that have been used to block it. If you want solar energy, what Glendale is doing now is not working. Glendale has about 200 solar systems installed. In other words, there are about 1,000 residents for each solar system, most of which are designed for power for two or three people. Having a couple tenths of a percent of power being solar is not enough. It's not nearly enough. A couple tenths of a percent won't help reduce the cancer caused by pollution. A couple tenths of a percent won't reduce asthma caused by pollution. A couple tenths of a percent won't reduce our dependence on oil. Won't do anything besides trying to trick people into thinking the city's doing something. Well, it doesn't trick me, and it doesn't trick anybody that looks around for solar systems. They're not there. The city is poisoning the well by squashing innovative solar systems. Innovation will commonly go against existing rules.
Mr. Peer, how much time do you have? We've let you go about 7 minutes. So if you can wrap it up in the next minute or so, that's great.
Okay, great. Yeah. Innovation is needed to go solar because the existing paradigm is not working. The city's application of zoning rules to solar systems is one of the reasons it's not working. You have a choice. You can join the dinosaurs who pretend that our current fossil fuel energy system should never change, but you can show leadership and recognize we should accelerate our conversion to clean, efficient energy that began in the 70s. Berkeley and Pasadena have removed all zoning restrictions on solar systems, just like option one. Things are going well for them. I'm not asking the city to take wild chances. I'm simply asking that we do the things that have already been proven to work in other cities. If Glendale accepts option one, removal of all zoning restrictions, the results will be more solar systems, less pollution, and a few complaints that are easily dismissed because it is the law. Please recommend option one.
Thank you very much. Any questions for the speaker?
Yeah, you mentioned how you never applied to go do a variance. Right, you were asked to do it. Did you not do it because you didn't think it would?
The only thing, Mr. Garcia may want to jump in. Let us know when we're getting a little too specific on a case that may come before us. I mean, we're talking about policy, and we're starting to focus on one particular case, which staff absolutely put into the report, focusing on one case, which actually kind of bothers me when we're using one specific case as a scenario. Are we okay talking this way, Mr. Garcia?
I think it's permissible to ask him if he wanted to apply for a variance, but obviously not to get into the merits of whether we think the variance would be justified. Because
thank you. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Sure. So yeah, why didn't you ever apply for a variance?
First of all, it was the moral thing that I thought it was illegal, and I don't think that solar systems should be subject to that. That it's important that we get solar energy going. This pollution, I mean, it's really serious. I mean, my wife has myeloproliferative disease, and that, like cancer, is caused by pollution generally. And pollution is the number two killer in the country. If you understand climate change, you know, that's another reason. And so I thought that I shouldn't be treated like this. And part of the reason why I wanted to do a solar system was not to do a 1 in 200,000 improvement in Glendale's pollution levels, but rather to be a leader and do an innovative system that others might look at it and say, oh, we can do this kind of system too. It doesn't just have to be a rooftop system.
Anything else at this time? Sure, Mr. Sheets.
A quick question. I think it's a question. I have a thought that I'd like you to just respond to. In your view, I mean, I know you're very passionate about what this is about, and have worked very hard and understand it very clearly, but is there any way or any time that you have thought about this issue just from a simple perspective that there is some question or some issue relative to structure, the structures, not your structure in particular, but this happens to be the one, but is there some question in your mind or some thoughts around the structure that is used not just with about the solar panels, but the structure and what impact that structure might have and the variations that might occur with structures if there's not some guidance or some direction. I'm not opposed in any way to what you want to do, but I from a broader perspective as a planning commissioner, there are always unintended consequences. There are always people that want to do something different, and that's fine. That's the way we work. But I have trouble not looking at those issues. So, just in a quick response, is there something or some thought you have in mind about the unintended consequences that unusual structures might have? And, in fact, that if we follow this legislation, that the people that know how to do this, the experts in planning and design engineering, will be... their hands will be tied as to how to follow up immediately when it's requested. And then in the long term, when things change, when technology changes, right now I feel like we're being told, don't worry about that. And I don't think that's a correct way for anybody to work, especially a city. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, I expect that as solar energy evolves that you know, there could be some problems that come up that need to be addressed. And I haven't heard that, you know, from talking to a guy in Berkeley is who I talked to in their city, you know, mostly. And they hadn't encountered anything yet. But which doesn't mean that as this whole thing evolves, something won't come up. I don't like unsafe structures any more than anybody else. So, you know, they would need to be treated like carports or other things when they're standalone and meet the standards. I'm an engineer, so when we had our structural engineer involved, you know, I watched closely and I asked him, okay, you know, what about the wind? You know, this thing, you know, could be like a sail. I don't want to fly away. You know, good.
So what about the aesthetic aspect if this thing gets out of control?
Yeah.
Because it seems that we're being told just do it. The aesthetics. The city works very hard from the very beginning and through time to be considered of that.
Yeah, and I think for sure there can be some people that don't like it just for their own, you know, what they're used to, or because some systems, I mean, they could really be aesthetically ugly, let's face it. But some of the people that I think don't like the aesthetics, it's actually that they actually don't like solar, and that's part of when I look at a solar system. I mean, I actually have never seen a solar system that I didn't like, because every time I see a solar system, I think,
about
great, you know, yeah, like all these good effects, you know, which are usually hidden away in the backcountry where the big coal-burning power plant is.
Yeah.
But that never actually leaves my consciousness. So I think of, okay, one less power plant.
Do you think there are people out there that would abuse it? And what do you think the consequences and or the solutions would be to deal with that?
I think that a city is already, they have a tendency to say no when you walk in there. And so I guess I didn't really see that as being a problem. I've had so much trouble with them, it's hard for me to imagine that they would just kind of slide a solar system through without thinking about it. After what I've been through, it's just hard for me to imagine that something that really was hideous in some way, that the person at the desk that was doing the permit wouldn't like say, oh, wait a minute, there's something going on here. You know, let's stop and figure out what the problem is. So I guess, theoretically possible, but it's hard for me to imagine just from my experience with, you know, walking in there and talking to
them. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions at this time? Anything for staff? Sure.
I would like to respond to what
I really don't want to get into that case.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk policy. The quid pro quo you can do, and you're off again.
Sure.
I mean, you're
fine. I have a question.
Yes, Mr. Lee.
Upland has mentioned about this notes, you know, the three items that was, you know, listed on there that says zoning standards that are presented in the draft ordinance adopted would have an effect on the current planning permitting process for solar energy commission.
I'm sorry, Mr. Lee, where are you?
That's page four.
Thank you.
And that's what he alluded to, that this really, you know, hasn't streamlined or hasn't made it any easy for solar equipment installer to come, because it's really what he's, you know, referring.
I think you can actually sit down.
As a more roadblock or steps for applicant to take. Now, I kind of read through, and it makes sense. I mean, to safeguard, for us to review, and really just to protect the applicant. But by looking at those three, you know, paragraphs there, is there something that we can do to streamline our process a little bit? I mean, this pretty much tells me that it's really saying, you know, we're going to review this thing, and, you know, just like any other project, you know. So I'm just throwing that out there. If this language could be modified, you know, when you pointed out that, you know, I mean, this pretty much is saying that, you know, it's still giving, hasn't really changed anything is what he's saying as far as the permitting process goes. So with the language in there safeguarding the city and the, I guess, the, you know, the project engineering, but can we make it somehow more, I guess, easier for applicant to take this project through?
I actually, so the question is, can we make the process any easier and in the face of the argument that was presented that this doesn't change? I actually take exception to the argument that it does, it doesn't change anything. In fact, it does. It really provides some parameters for staff at the counter to actually make some determinations to see if, in fact, this falls through those parameters and they could process it quickly. If the idea is to remove all processing, no, it doesn't do that, and we actually do not recommend that, because we do think that there is a place where we need to step in.
So you feel that this is the minimum?
This is the minimum. Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm happy with that.
Ms. Landrigan?
Well, I was going to say something similar to what Mr. Hagani said. I think there has to be a process, and I think this process is quite simple. I don't believe there should be no process at all, because, and this is also in the staff report, this isn't in the ordinance, so it's not anything but how the process is going to be, pretty much setting it into place. And I think that Mr. Sheet's questions were valid. I think I think Mr. Garcia was very clear as to what a city has rights to do, and I think that the attorney's interpretation is to my satisfaction, and I think that we've simplified this process to be, having been a planner for the city of Santa Monica, which has far many more processes than you can imagine, I can tell you that this is an extremely streamlined approach. So to me, it seems that we've actually made it so that you have a consistency of each planner applying it as opposed to an inconsistency. And without this, I don't think you could guarantee that.
Well, I just wanted to address it because he addressed it, and I wanted staff to respond to that.
I actually got another speaker card, so we'll let them speak. You have Ms. Theard, 3 minutes.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm Lynn Theard. I'm married to the solar guy. Anyway, I wanted to respond to what you asked, Mr. Sheets, because my husband and I have actually had lively debates about. And there are a couple things that tend to get lost. If you read the legislation that was crafted by the state, it specifies that the primary purpose of what is being constructed is solar energy. It can't be to enhance your square footage. It can't be to do any other embellishments to one's property. So primary purpose is in there, but tends to get a little overlooked. The other thing is that you mentioned concerns not just about aesthetic, but also about structural integrity, about people putting up things that will withstand. And as we had noted, we went to a great deal of effort for that. But that is also included in the legislation. If you read the law, it says that it has to be acceptable. It has to come up to the health and safety, the building standards for structural integrity. So that is built in. And then the third thing is aesthetic. And that was something that was actually addressed in a memo by the legislator who sponsored the bill and got it through the state, Lois Wolk. And she specifically wanted to include exclude aesthetics because she felt aesthetics had been used as a barrier to solar energy. And the other thing she specifically addressed in her memo was onerous permitting process and costs. So those areas have been covered, and that memo was included in correspondence that was sent to us initially by Mr. Garcia. So I wanted to address that for you.
I have a question.
Thank you.
Yes. Question, please.
Of course.
Thank you very much for your comments. And I think the very thing that you referred to about the legislation that came down that addressed, you know, the building standards. Now, how do you propose then the city to oversee, safeguard the applicant and also the safety of the equipment, the integrity of the equipment,
right,
and all this without having the permit process or the check and balance system that we have to implement this type of building structures? How do you, I mean, the legislation is there, yes, it says, you know, you have to meet the codes and all that, that it has to be strong, you know, sound, but without city having that type of process, how do you propose that this be controlled?
Well, it seems what we are discussing here is zoning, and zoning is a separate issue from the building standards, as I understand it. Now, there is some overlap, because zoning takes into account things that really have nothing to do with structural integrity. It takes into account how many feet you have to have your driveway, how far you have to be from an adjacent structure. That's not necessarily, the integrity of a structure is not necessarily incumbent on those issues. So those zoning issues are different than the issues of structural integrity.
But you also understand that we feel that zoning is related to the safety.
I understand, but zoning is also related in a great degree to how people want their community structured. There is definitely perhaps a component of safety, for sure, but it's not absolute because there are too many exceptions to that go on with almost any project in an area like Glendale that is so dense and so built out that it's very hard to do anything, whether it's commercial, multifamily, or single family, without taking those aspects into account. And that's mainly what zoning does. How many people do you want to have living in an area? What kind of density do you want to have? How do you want it to look? That seems to be more of zoning, and then by its extension, what we've developed here in Glendale, the design review process.
Ms. Lander?
Not necessarily the construction area.
Zoning actually sets standards that protect the health, safety, and welfare also. Welfare is the issue that you're having a hard time putting your mind around, and most people do. But anything that happens on your property is not a solo act. You are part of a community,
right,
and a property line is crossed by ants every day and flown over by birds.
Right.
We are the only people who think that property line defines something really tangible.
Mm-hmm.
And in reality, I'm sorry, it's really not a discussion unless I ask you a question.
Okay.
So it's a lecture, in other words.
Okay. It was already...
Or a soliloquy.
Well, it's not. What happens with zoning is that it deals, you were giving us your definition of it,
sure,
and I'm giving you a different definition.
Okay.
So what zoning deals with is community standards.
Right, exactly.
And those standards do have something to do with health, safety, and welfare, or they wouldn't be able to stand on anything. That is not their sole there. integral. I mean, medicine has to do with health, safety, and welfare, and yet oftentimes it kills you.
Mm-hmm.
So there are those gray areas. So I'm just saying that there are issues like that.
Mm-hmm.
And just wanted to give you a different definition.
I'm just going to say, I think we've heard
sure.
your sides as well.
Okay.
We'll be sharing okay. our sides. It's not really a free-flowing conversation.
Okay.
I do believe you've been effective in presenting what your
right.
your opinions and your arguments are.
And thank you for listening.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You. Closing or further comments on your part?
No more comments. I think we've said everything already, or whatever we could say.
Okay.
The rest is in the draft ordinance. We pointed out some possible clarifications to the draft ordinance. This is the direction of the Planning Commission. We can go forward with this ordinance with the clarification, unless the Planning Commission has some other changes to make.
All right. Well,
I have a question. Mm-hmm. I want to get a clarification on the street front setback on page 38. Does this mean, so if it's not allowed unless there's a building footprint along the setback, you're saying the solar panel is allowed in that instance? Is that what it means?
Within that footprint.
Right.
Yes.
Within that footprint, so it's on top of that structure.
Yes.
Right? So essentially, like, this would be, this specific case would be permitted, right?
Actually, no, and we pointed out some of the issues.
No, yeah. Not under this.
Because the proposal extends beyond that
right.
footprint.
Footprint
some of it is solar is covered with solar panels, and some of it is not covered okay. with solar panels. So we pointed out some of the possible
okay.
Issues that this proposal may have with respect to this ordinance.
I guess, Chair.
Please, Mr. Lee.
So before, I guess, we go into deliberation, I just wanted to be clear on the, you know, what we are doing with this, the tables. So are we suggesting to leave the solar coming in there and take out those strikes that we had there. Okay. And then just add a
That's
little
what I heard.
Comment. Okay.
We can do that, and we can refer to the code section that
sure. okay.
addresses solar panels.
All right. Well, let's close the public hearing. Let's enter deliberations. We can always reopen, as we frequently do, or incessantly do. Who'd like to lead off? Ms. Landrigan.
Well, mm-hmm.
I hardly ever lead off.
Ready to go.
Oh, look at you.
I think this is a huge improvement over what we have, and I called Chris up and asked him a couple of questions after I read through it. And I think I know where Mr. Lee is going, and I kind of just want to have a discussion what we think about a portion of this, and that is I understand the reason for saying that something needs to be maintained, the footprint of it, but I'm thinking as a designer now. I put my designer hat on, not just my commissioner hat. And to me, sometimes one of the elements that you need when you are doing a structural element and you are using the existing building as part of the structure, I think defining it within the existing footprint is an assumption that footprint follows the walls of the building, whereas in essence we could say the footprint could be that if it's a cantilever footprint, it goes out to where the concrete is poured to. And, I mean, there is a definition, but I think that in some instances when it exceeds the walls of the building, or if it's an overhang, that there could be a percentage of projection that it could have for applications. Connections or something of that ilk that would maintain the structural integrity of it. I when I read through that, and I too had a concern using one example, the guinea pig, in essence, of this over and over again. But I understand we're really trying to make this so that we have a consistency, but at the same time I see that there is some structural reasoning that might mean that you would use the existing walls. You would not want to set it in on something that was not structurally sound, and that might create, when you're doing any attachments to it, elements that would overhang or project outside of that area. So to me, that's the only thing in here that I think is should still be sort of discussed.
Sure. I kind of go along with that because interpretation of this new ordinance, I think still has some handcuffing effect, or that's why I asked what the definition of the solar equipment and you know the structure that's supporting it. So if it becomes incidental to that, I think there should be some sort of a language in there to maybe allow certain variances, because otherwise the people that who follows the contour of the wall, as Ms. Landrigan said, but happen to be protruding into that setback area, have to come before us for variance. And I don't think that's the right way to go. So I think, I don't know what you're proposing, but if you allow, language in there for, something like that of incidental to installation of the solar panels, and that involves, some structures protruding out into the setback area, I'm good with that, too.
Okay. Who else would like to pipe in initially?
I'm also agree with all the what's been said so far, and I also agree that for this solar panels and having solar panels, we do need to have some guidelines. And what we have here is an improvement from what we have before. And I think it does a lot for the city, trying to give an incentive for providing incentives for solar panels to happen here, maybe more so than other cities, I don't know, but I think we're doing a good job of doing that, and I would be supportive of what we have here, and I don't have anything else to add.
Mr. Sheets?
Okay. My feeble mind has conflicting thoughts about how we deal with this. I think we've had great interactions and wonderful input. I have difficulty from the standpoint that I can't help but think about the one case that we're dealing with, but we're really talking about something broader than that, and I'm trying to get my mind to stay focused that way, because I like nothing more than for you to have had this solar structure in years ago, but we'll get there. I'll just kind of building on the questions I had earlier. I'll share my thoughts, and then we can go from there. I have trouble with the height issue. I don't know why any solar panel, quote unquote, would need to be that high. And I don't think I'll ever understand that, and I don't think I'll be happy with that. But I see how this occurred, and I'm not against what the case that we have before us used as an example. Any solar panels that I've seen, whether they're thousands of panels in the desert or on top of buildings, I've never seen any of them that had to be this high. But we have an example of such. Most, as far as, I guess, from the aspect of being a standard, most structures would not have to be that high. What standards will we have in place if we have these structures that don't exist today at varying heights? What will be the standard, or how will we maintain those structures? It's something that we don't even have in place. We don't even have any guidelines or plans for or standards. Guess I have concerns as to where this might lead if the technology changes, which I mentioned before, and the current standard panels become obsolete. What will the city codes have in place as to removing or retrofitting existing structures and or panels? Now, my concern there is it's something we don't have in place, and we're leaving the door open that it can be X feet, Y feet, or whatever, But if it changes and that no longer fits the bill, then what do we do? Do we leave those there? Do we retrofit? Do we have some thought, if we put any thought into if the standard today is one thing and we use that and we put that in place, what if that changes and what do we do? And I guess the answer would be or could be that we would do what's appropriate relative to the new standards. But sometimes I feel like this legislation is saying, don't do that. Don't go there. So I think when we talked about the one statement that was made about the zoning, I think the zoning really gets around the aesthetics and the compatibility aspect, which this legislation kind of directs us not to really focus on. And I think all of the components around planning and the Planning Commission relative to zoning and the laws are all necessary to make this thing work. So I'm not opposed to the new plan that's being presented. I just have concerns, and I don't know how we put those things into our suggestion to the council, and I'm not even sure that I don't sense that anybody else has the same concerns that I'm having, so I at least wanted to get them on the record. So,
okay. I guess my initial thoughts are, and I guess my prejudices betray me a little bit on a couple of counts. Whenever anybody brings up words like Berkeley and Pasadena, well, I'm just naturally inclined to disagree. But getting past that, and I think I mentioned before, you know, I have solar panels on my home, but I had it easy. I have a big south-facing roof. It's on the back of the house. I'm hillside. My panels don't affect anyone, never would. They're flush with the roof. I'm like a poster child for no impact to the community. That said, I don't think the city of Glendale's anti-solar at all. I think what happened with the state law had to do with some other communities that were actually, you know, finding ways not to install solar. I think all that's happened is Glendale's just working through what their previous ordinances had been. They're trying to respond to the state law, but I don't think it's, I think the key to everything has been the word reasonable. And I absolutely think it's reasonable that the planning department takes a look at what's being planned and how it impacts the neighborhood or the community at large. That's just reasonable. And again, it just keeps going back to reasonable. It's not necessarily reasonable to require somebody that's prepared and has their facts and has their information placed to go in, let's say, 10 times or wait, you know, a year for hearings or things like that. But it is reasonable for them to have to go in a couple times as they come in with inadequate plans or there's questions to be asked or things are challenged. There will clearly be abuses. I mean, it's just the nature of things that people will come up with really half-cocked, crazy ideas that aren't right. I'm not indicating any particular situation, but it will happen. I mean, through our travels around the countryside, I'm sure we've seen some really outstandingly ugly and inappropriate installations for solar. To me, in fact, there I have some concern, echoing a little bit of what Mr. Sheet said about heights and stuff, I have some concern that we've almost gone a little bit too far down the path of less restrictions, but I also see us trying to embrace both the spirit of the law and still trying to react to the community at large. People will disagree about what does the state law mean versus what a community can do, but as far as I'm concerned, you know, going back to reasonable, it's reasonable for a community to implement reasonable restrictions or reasonable suggestions to a process. I'd also go at some point, it's impossible for every home to have solar. I mean, you know, if the state law was every home should be entitled to solar, well, you're going to have a home that's in a canyon that faces north that suddenly is going to be allowed to put up telephone poles to be insane, it would put up telephone poles 100 feet in the air to be able to grab solar. That's probably a little too far down the road of reasonableness. So somewhere between that and being able to, like we were able to do at my house, just slap them on the roof and walk away happy, there's got to be something in that area where everybody can you know, reasonably implement the idea of embracing solar energy. So that said, you know, I'm pretty content with the way staff has drafted the ordinance. We've made some comments between Mr. Sheets' comments and the things we said about page 38. And there was a couple other things. Would someone like to help me what we had mentioned earlier?
You have.
What Ms. Landrigan and Mr. Lee pointed out about projection of the panels beyond the footprint, I'm sorry, we may have distracted you because we were talking about different scenarios of how to do that. If you would like us to put reasonable projection and between now and the time we go to the City Council, give us the spectrum of flexibility that we need to propose maybe different measures to the City Council by the time we go there, we can take that direction.
Okay, and I know words like reasonable are tough words.
Yes.
What is reasonable? But, you know, at some point you can't pin down everything to inches and feet. I mean, it's just, you know, there's you know, thousands of properties, there's thousands of conditions.
Maybe at the discretion of the reviewer.
Yeah, and again, reasonable, there'll always be some arguments about reasonable, but I would always like to say, oh, it'd be great to be empirical and pin something down, but there's too many variables.
If you give us the direction, we will present some options in terms of measures, whether they're percentages or actual inches or whatever. We will present options to the City Council if you feel comfortable that we can work out that detail between now and the City Council meeting.
I mean, I would urge you to do it, you know, and then let City Council bounce back as to, you know, how appropriate that is. What other things have we been brought up in discussions that we want to make sure our motion of support to council, you know, that information is presented to them in their report? You guys remember, I know we talked about page 5, and it's been confirmed that language should be kept in.
Right. Mm-hmm. Restore.
And 12.
Yeah, 12.
And 12.
Yeah,
you.
Page 5 and 12.
I just want to, I guess all I would say is, if staff would simply review our discussion and our conversations, as well as public comment, and add that to the information being presented to council, I think I'd welcome somebody making a motion to recommend. Ms. Landrigan.
Well, I will move that consideration of the proposed draft ordinance to facilitate the installation of solar energy equipment. That upon consideration of this, that the Planning Commission hereby recommends that the City Council adopt proposed option 2C with suggestions as brought up in conversation as an amendment to Title 30 of the Glendale Municipal Code, 1995. Now I'd like discussion.
Now you'd like discussion?
Well, I had to wait until we had a motion to discuss this one thing.
Well, okay.
I just don't have a concern with the height. I think that if you look at the, if you're going to put a trellis up, you have a clearance of a minimum of 7'6". 8 feet is not unreasonable. If you have a 4-foot panel and you have to have a solar orientation of 45 degrees, that's a 4-foot height. That's a 1-to-1 orientation. And you have a top structure that's a foot, you got 13 feet there, and you may have to raise it up somewhat so that you have your foundation. So I don't think 14 feet is unreasonable. I think it's reasonable. So I just wanted to state that.
That's probably where that was driven from,
right?
Too.
Well,
that math.
I feel comfortable with that number as well. Yeah.
Sure.
The 15-foot that we came up with in the draft ordinance is also the 15-foot height limitation that applies to residential accessory structures. So it's the same figure that we used.
Okay. Hearing closed.
Just one comment. I guess there's really no room in the second or the motion to change his name to the Solar Man.
I think it was Solar Guy.
Just kidding.
Solar
Guy.
I thought it was Solar Plexus myself.
All right. Sorry.
All right. We have a motion searching support. Next we have support. Call roll, please.
Commissioner Lee, you.
Supported, yeah.
Okay.
Aye.
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 I have a vote of 5-0. The Planning Commission has recommended zoning code amendment case PZON 2009-001 be adopted by the City Council with comments as noted. Planning Department updates, please. Okay. Comments from commissioners.
This is the last weekend that you can see the Art from the Ashes exhibit that's in the right across from the Americana at the Brand, on Brand, and it's open Saturday from 12 till 6, and it's open every day the rest of this week from 12 till 6. And we'd love to have you come and see the art and the amazing things that can come from a fire's remains. So I urge you all to come.
I just have a quick comment on this. One of the, I guess, files that was came attached, Montrose Collection. There's a denial notification for zoning use certificates. Are they still in business? I know they came before us.
Mr. Argani?
That's just the ZEC denial. Yes.
Well, if I could just briefly, they are still operating illegally in our view, but we've been in litigation with them.
Oh,
I can't speak too much to it.
I thought that just was a closed, you know, case.
They do not have permits to operate. That's
they
correct.
Do not have permits. Okay.
Right. Anything else from the commission? Seeing none, motion to adjourn, please. We are adjourned.